to buy stuff for me and my kids, no, but her and her kids, but she's just burning money. And you can think of what that money could have done, you know, if we had used our head. But, you know, somebody's spending their money, you ain't gonna fight with them, you're gonna go right there along with them. That's your money. Right? Amen. Any questions before we move on to our next lesson? Why does God, any comments, any questions?
Also,
lesson number two. Debt present. Summary of God's word about our debt. What God's word says on our debt. What does God have to say about debt? If you review everything that the Bible has to say about debt, it is clear that God discourages debt. And he warns of the dangers of debt. Proverbs 22 and 7. It is not a sin to borrow money, but it's a sin to borrow and not repay. Hello. How many Christians borrow people's money or buy stuff from people and stop answering the phone when they call for payment? These Christians, I ain't talking about you. I'm not talking about people that are not Christians. But you expect to respect me. When I was in the world, I sinned and that was it. You expect me not to pay my bill. Hello, my word didn't mean a thing. But when I came on the Lord's side, I had a different, a life change. My word is supposed to mean something. But how many Christians are setting up in the house of God ordering these people stuff and won't pay for it? Psalm 37:21 states that the wicked borrow and do not pay, but the righteous give generously. So if you call yourself a child of the living God and you're not repaying these people their stuff, you're wicked. That's what the Bible says. and so that folk know you. They don't want to loan you their money. Well, can you lend me $10? And if they know you, they say, you know what, just don't worry about it. Here's the 10. Because they know they won't see that $10 no more. They don't see them come out lending. When you know you have no intention of paying back. Already when you went to that person, you had no intention of paying it back. So the implication is that the righteous person not only repays all of their debts, but they go a second mile and they give to people that need. They give generously to those that are in need. So what kind of light into the world darkness is a Christian who does not repay his debt on time or pay it at all?
Amen.
Jesus said, Matthew 5 and 16, in the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Right. You don't want folks to say, and I've heard this so many times, especially I work at the Marriott, those that don't know, and I work in the sales department. Sometimes I'm at the front desk helping out. And Christians like preachers, big name preachers that have checked in, name preachers, that have checked in and brought embarrassment to the name of Christianity. To the point that most of the people in the hotel say, oh Lord, another Christian?
Yeah.
Or when there's a Christian event, oh Lord, them Christians are not here. Come on, people. Then I have friends that work in the restaurant industry. They go, well, the Christians, they don't check them. They don't tell. And then here we are on Sunday. People want to be off. Because they know Christians. Don't know the Christians come to the restaurant Sunday. But they don't even tip. But we're supposed to be portraying the gospel. He said, so that men will see your good deeds and do what? Praise God. Because, man, those Christians are something else. We wonder why folk don't come to the house of God. We are the one, we're the reason why. When the Bible says the judgment will start in the house of God, you think it's because of some other reason? Because Christians are not doing what they're supposed to do in the house of God. And so, you know, in the church, no. Everywhere you go, you got to consider yourself being in the house of God. Because you are the house of the living God. So everywhere you go, and no matter what situation or what circumstance it is, you have to portray Christianity in everything you do. I can't tell you the Christians, even ministers, that are just the things that they do that stoop so low, God is going to judge them. I can't say nothing about that. But I pray for them because God himself is going to judge that. And we don't want to get caught up in that kind of situation. So I'm aware that most people, and not to mention married couples, will have to borrow some money at some point in their life, particularly for buying a home or whatever you can, maybe you're buying a car. So before borrowing any money, you need to sit down and devise a plan. Do some homework. I recommend that you do a couple of things. But first of all, we have to understand that when you go to, especially go to the car, they already got their plan. They done been rehearsing that script. They already got it down to a science. Don't you love how they say, well, let me go see what my manager say. Come on. You already know. Bishop said, now listen, you ain't got to do all that. Just tell me what you want. I tell you if I can pay it. I tell you what I can pay it. ate up each other, we gone. So I'm just running around back and forth. Let me see, my manager said this, come on, that's a lie. So they play us until they get the money that they want to get you so in trap. And the best is when they put you in that car and let you drive around. They know they got you. Ah, that smooth ride, you almost don't want to get out. You want to sign the papers right there in the car and take it on home. So they got you. They already devised that plan. So you got to have a plan before you go. One, you got to develop a budget to ensure that you can afford the loan payments.
That's right.
That scripture, Luke 14:28-30 tells you that. Luke 14:28-30 let you know that you got to develop a plan or a budget to ensure that you can afford the loan payment. Don't get out there taking it. And now listen, people get, the Lord blessed me with a Cadillac. And I'm like, wait a minute, don't you work for me?
Come on now. Jesus.
Is it paying for? No, but the payments ain't but so much.
Oh, God.
Child, forgot you got to pay rent. Forgot you got to buy groceries. Got children. Now you got Cadillac sitting up in low-income apartment.
Come on.
Get off of there. God did not bless you with that. If he gave you money, he told you to use that money in a different manner, but you were there to go to Cadillac. And now, 3 months down the line, you're on the bus again. Where's the car? Well, I'm still getting payments, but God blessed you with that.
Wow.
Right.
We need to know the difference. We want to think that God blessed me with this, God blessed me with that. Use wisdom now.
Yes.
If it's paid for, it's a blessing. If you can afford it, it's a blessing. He will allow you to afford it. But don't think you're going to run out there in your backyard overnight and a money tree grew up and you're going to make my payment in the morning. That ain't the kind of God.
Yes, sir.
If you're looking for that kind of miracle, forget it. You won't get that kind of miracle, right? It's not a sin to borrow money, but it is a sin to borrow money and not repay it. Again, Proverbs 37:21, remember, the wicked borrow do not pay, but the righteous give generously. The implication is that the righteous person is not only repaying all their debts, but they go that second mile. Let's go. I'm going to pay. I'm going to give. I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do in God. So, number one. Number two, present the need to God in prayer. And give God a chance to answer.
Amen.
Oh, you know how we do. The Lord said, go ahead. Wait a minute. You just said two words. The Lord told me to go ahead and do it. And then things don't work out. Why you let me do that? I ain't open my mouth. I didn't give me a chance to say nothing. You got up and took off running. A lot of times because we already have in our heart what we want. And so we pray, we go down in prayer, and we say, God said, go ahead, because we already wanted it anyway. We have not heard God speaking. God can't speak to you in that frame of mind anyway. He ain't say nothing to you while you're down there on your knees. So just go ahead on and wait for God. Wait to hear from God and stop moving so quick. We get inside ourselves. Proverbs 37:7. So to provide the cash or an alternative at lower cost. Often Christians buy things on credit without even giving God a chance to meet the need in a manner that is glorifying to him. Psalms 107:8-9. We need to glorify God. We need to say, Lord, you know, I was talking to my sister, and I'm not going to call her name unless she want to raise her hand. And she told me she paid her for her car cash. And I thought, awesome, God.
Hallelujah.
We can do that.
Yes.
And stop all this borrowing money and loans and all this kind of stuff like this. We don't have to do it that way, but we so anxious and so antsy. The way she said it, she said, I saved my money.
Right.
That's right. There she is. Thank you, baby. I saved my money. Thank you. Paid cash for my ass. Why can't we do that? What in the world is wrong with doing that? But we got to get the payment, and they want to lock you down, and you don't pay double for a car. Actually, triple, because actually the factory cost is not even close to what you're paying.
That's right.
They've already doubled it before they put it in the showroom for
it.
And now the loan company tripled it. So what you doing?
Right.
You buying about 4 or 5 cars for one car. They got you. That's what they want to do. They want to give you credit. You got a job, they'll give you credit. They don't care nothing about that.
Mm-hmm.
They get their money off the top, but your down payment, that's theirs.
Right.
The salesman got his money. So he got, you know, when he say only $500, and then you go home and he say, I need $500 more to come and get the car. They trap you there because they say, now you got the car, you've had it a couple of days, and you ain't going to want to give it up.
Wow.
And you're going to find some more money to give me if I come back and get that car. They play us that way.
Wow.
And so we want the car so bad, we jump right in.
Right.
Number three, in prayer, ask God if it is really a need. God has promised to meet our needs, Matthew 6, 31 through 33, but not necessarily the wants and the desires. He said he'll give us the desires of our heart, but he promised to meet our needs.
Yes.
And you can ask him, God, do I really need, is this really a need? I want it, but is it really a need?
Yes.
And number four, most importantly, spend quality time with the Lord in prayer, seeking God's wisdom, James 1 and 5, and God's specific direction. In other words, does he want you to borrow the money or not? God has promised to direct us. We just need to allow him to direct us.
Uh-huh.
Psalms 32 and 8 says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you and watch over you.
Amen.
We just have to let him do it. God wants to instruct us. He wants to teach us. He wants to guide us. We need to stop being impulse spenders. If we sit down and count every dollar that comes through our hand, and then the money that we spent out legally to pay bills and the money that we threw frivolously, we'll see that sometimes the frivolous spending outweighs the real money. And this is money we could have had in our pocket where we struggled. We didn't have to struggle.
Right?
Amen.
Amen.
So in summary, God's perspective on debt is very different than the world's perspective. The mindset of most people is to buy now, pay later.
Mm-hmm.
Or smart people use other people's money. Y'all remember that?
Yeah.
That seminar?
That's why he says
other people's money. But on the other hand, God's desire is for us to use the minimal debt or no debt. Deuteronomy 28, 1 through 14. By saving for our future needs rather than borrowing, Proverbs 21, 20. God has promised that alone he will meet our needs, and my God will meet all of your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus, Philippians 4, 19. What God says about debt, he preferred that we didn't have it. Debt hinders a lot. It hinders our move in God. We're always worrying about how I'm going to pay this and how I'm going to pay that. We have the cable TV, we have internet, we got the telephone. There's a lot of stuff that we can just condense and shorten some of that stuff. And some of us, like me, watch like three channels on the whole TV. Christian TV USA and Channel 7 News. And sometimes I get so mad with them with the Playgirl, Weather Girls, and I go to Channel 4 News. But that's it. Come on. There's nothing else you want to watch. I have to watch Psych on Wednesday night. That's just part of my, that's just what I am.
Mm-hmm.
Now, okay, you know, y'all have your problem. I got to watch Psych.
Right.
And my sister over there is like, did you see Psych this week? Yeah, I saw it. I got people at work watch. Sometimes you like good, clean humor.
Yeah.
Well, ain't nobody in bed. Ain't nobody cussing and doing all the stuff. But just good, clean stupidness.
Yeah.
And that's what Psych is about. I like it. It's fun.
Right.
So I get a laugh. A good, clean laugh. They don't do that no more on TV. I'm scared to watch TV, scared to turn on TV. I saw a commercial one time. By the time this lady got through walling all over the car, I asked Bishop, I said, well, what was the commercial? What they selling? She had on this red dress on the car. The red dress was up in the air, and I was like, well, what are they selling? He said, I don't know. I saw that commercial a couple times. I still don't know. It took me about three times to find out it was for a car. She was advertising the car. I didn't see the car because all I saw her flying over the car with a red dress on. So, you know, you don't know what you turn on the TV. Even the commercial is scary. And your kids are sitting there with, you know, they got your kids all just sucked into it. So we need to stop that. One day we know the scripture of the Lord says, God promised to meet our needs. Matthew 6, 31 and 33. God promised to meet our needs. Number three. Perhaps God's greatest financial promise to believers is that he will meet our needs as we pray in first. Jesus said, so do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans ran after all these things. And your heavenly Father knows that you have need of them. But first, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. His righteousness.
Yes.
And everything else will be added unto you as well.
Uh-huh.
I always tell people, what, you know, it's God did this, God did that. Sometimes we're so amazed. The thing that gets me, why Christian or man when God heal your body. That's just God.
That's
the attribute of being a Christian.
Right.
Expect that. We didn't expect him to do the things that he normally do.
That's
it's like a child going to the refrigerator and your mom said, "Ooh, we got food."
Okay.
Like, if you're a parent, you said, "Ooh, we got food." Deeper and deeper.
Yeah.
Until I got upside down on my own.
Right.
So you make those kind of mistakes, but thank God for a way out. And so Apostle Paul confirmed this in Philippians 4:19. He said, "And my God with all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus."
Yes.
But we have no obligation to this principle as well. Have an obligation. We have to take care of men and the women of God who really do it well. If we read further, before we get to the 19th chapter verse, if we read a little further, he was thanking them because they took care of him. And then a lot of the people I went and ministered to, they give me nothing.
Oh,
they did not, you know, supply my need. But you, and even in your need, sent me money to help me out. And because you did that, my God will supply all of your needs. See, that's what it's all about.
Every time I look around, they ask him for money. That's why you don't have none now.
That's what it's in your pocket and think you're going to grow. You won't grow with that.
Amen.
So, nowhere in the Bible did God ever direct anyone to borrow money in order for God to meet our needs.
Amen.
Because God is an all-powerful, all-knowing, and present everywhere God. When we need him, God decides. He will provide. He does so utilizing his own resources.
Thank you.
King David testified in Psalm 37:25. He said, "I was young and now I am old." Everybody know the word? "Yet I've never
seen the righteous
forsaken. Amen. Never seen you forsaken nor your children. You neither your children will be begging for bread. You will not be forsaken." Amen. The righteous. Those that are under the leadership of Jesus Christ, are under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, never forsaken, never begging for bread. God said, "I need all of your needs." All of them. Amen?
Amen.
So there are many examples of God's miraculous provision in the Bible, and here are a few. One, God provided the Israelites with manna for 40 years in the desert, Exodus 16:35. Two,
Jesus fed 4,000, 5,000 families with seven loaves and a few, 4,000 families with seven loaves and a few fish, Matthew 5, 35 to 38. 3, God provided for Elijah's needs by the ravens during a severe drought, 1 Kings 17, 13 to 16. 5, God provided for the Israelites by making Joseph the PM, or the property manager of Egypt. Genesis 41, 41 and 45 and 7. 6, on many occasions, Christ met needs by healing the sick. For example, Matthew 4 and 24 and Matthew 8 and 16. So therefore, would it not make more sense for us as Christians or as children of the Lord to trust God for our finances? He's not the lender, so we don't have to trust the lender. The Bible said we shall lend and not borrow. We need to become the lenders now and stop being the borrowers. He didn't say you shall borrow and not lend. We got it backwards. But he said we shall lend and not borrow to meet the needs. Yes. Of course it does. God, we trust God. He's going to meet our needs. Obedience is always the best way to be blessed. Deuteronomy 28, 1 through 14 tells us that obedience brings blessings. Always. Always brings blessings. God has promised to meet our needs, but not necessarily our wants and our desires. So in essence, sometimes, the more often than we think, what we say our needs are not really our needs. They are our wants and our desires. For example, say a person is earning $40,000 a year, and he's at the top of the 5% of all income earners in the world. We are very wealthy, but we don't realize it. And so often we believe that our needs are not being met, when in fact they are. In Matthew 6, 31 and 33, Jesus said that needs included food, shelter, and clothing. Food, drink, and clothing. Similarly, in Timothy 6, 6 through 8, Paul said, but godliness with contentment is great. For we brought nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. In summary, God does not need a lender of any kind in order to accomplish his will. Isaiah 46, 9 through 11. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Revelation 19, 16. Unfortunately, though, Christians often borrow money without, one, consulting God, which is 1 Kings 22 and 5, two, asking God to provide, Matthew 7 and 7, and John 15 and 7, and three, waiting for his provision, Psalm 31 and 7. We need to learn to wait on God. Amen. So God admonishes us not to worry, but rather that we put him first and he will meet our needs. Hebrews 12, chapter 12, verse 27 through 31. Put God first in all that you do, and not to worry. God promised to meet our needs. We need to understand that it's not just an old cliche. Sometimes we think we take Bible scriptures as just a byword or just something. Oh, that was a good message. And that sounded good. And hoorah, you know, awesome. But then God is looking for us to move on what we learn. Yeah, so we want to get knowledge of it, then walk in it. Yeah. We haven't moved and it was a good word and it was awesome and all that kind of stuff, but we haven't made any changes. We haven't even walked in that direction. The Bible says, who much is given, more will be given. Who has much more will be given unto them. So if you got more, because you're building more. And that's why you're getting more.
That's right.
But if you ain't got little, you're going to lose that you got. Why? Because you're sitting there holding it in your pocket.
I ain't going to do it. It's mine.
And you're going to lose that.
Yes.
Huh?
Amen.
Amen.
That's it.
Amen.
Amen. I want to make y'all tired. Everybody stand up. What time is it? All right. Can we just take a break? I don't want y'all to get tired of it. It's just 5 minutes. Run to the back, touch the wall, and come back.
Oh, yeah.
Woo!